Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And good morning from wherever you are, and good whatever. If this is being watched worldwide, it may not necessarily be morning, but it is morning here in Kenya, and a cold morning or a cool one. Thank you for the invitation, and thank you for the chance to be with you. I saw what you did there, Soya with Sire. That's a nice one. One week usually flies very quickly, and we just want to get into the meat of everything. This week's theme for the camp meeting is In His Time, In His Time. And what it gets me thinking about is how God views and how God uses time differs from how we view and therefore how we use time. The way we view and we use or approach or interpret the things of time is because of who we are. We see time in our way, and therefore we struggle with things like delay, denial, death, deferment, because how we view time is in a very particular way, and therefore we struggle with those aspects of time, like when we think there's been delay, when we think there's been denial, when we think death has happened, when we experience death, when something has been deferred, and many other aspects or aberrations of time that happen to us become big challenges. But as I was preparing, I began thinking, if we saw and if we understood time the way God sees and understands, and therefore how he uses time, it would markedly influence or improve our relationship with him and our relationship with the things that we experience in time. In time we receive God, or in time we reject God. It is within time that we marry. It is within time that we are given marriage. It is it is in time that we make our career choices. It is in time that we do everything. But the central crux for me for this entire week, at least for the morning devotion, is just a simple statement that you probably will hear every morning, is so his time, his way, then we would let him lead us in this time, in his way. If we store his time in his way, then we would let him lead us in this life, in his way. So morning after morning, that will really just be the crux of the matter, to begin seeing this concept of time through God's lenses. Now, two more things that I need to say is that, number one, I am a believer in the third part of our name, Adventist. The fact that God is coming soon to take his people home is, for me, real. It's true. It's not just part of our name. It's not just a nice, cheesy mantra that we say. It's true. And prophecy tells us that before Christ comes, therefore, the second time, there'll be certain events that will happen that will test all the inhabitants of the world. And it is my firm belief, at least when I read the Bible, that what therefore God wants us to do is to use this time now to get information that will help us prepare for those times. You see, you play the way you practice, you play the way you practice. And it is my studied belief, therefore, that when we go through a sermon like this, or sermon series, or a cup meeting like this, that we are practicing the way we will pray. We will play down the road. So that's point number one. Then point number two is this. The Bible for me is a book which, in when you read in the book of 2 Peter chapter 2, it Second Peter chapter 3, sorry, it asks the powerful question, seeing all these things will be overturned in this manner, what manner of people ought we to be now as we look forward and haste to the coming of the day of the Lord? And it says, my brethren, do all your diligence and you may be found in him without spot, without blemish. So the Bible in its writing is written with two objectives. Objective number one is it'll help us prepare for the life to come, for the events that I've seen, the whole Adventist belief. But then Bible is written number two, that we may be able to live this life. So those two realities influence how I would like to approach this entire thing. And the whole idea is that I would like to be able to, by God's grace, as we look at how God looks at and uses time, that in it we may be able to learn principles that will apply for us in this life, and simultaneously use that as an experience that will help us practice, so that in the things that we are told are coming, before we can enter the life to come, we would be found to have practiced properly, so that when the real plays of life come, we will be ready. Simply put, I'm really burdened to make sure what we study is clear, it is relevant, and it is applicable. I make that long introduction, one, so that those who are not acquainted to my person can be, and two, so that as you follow along, you have a sense of where this guy is going and where I feel God is impressing or putting upon my heart to be able to lead us to go. So that notwithstanding, now we can, I know prayer has been made. I just request that I may be able to pray one more time and we can be able to move. Lord, I pray that as we study your word, you'll be our strength and give us clarity. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Turn with me to my favorite book in the Bible. It's a book of Genesis. Go with me to its very beginning, Genesis 1. And Genesis is my favorite book because it is a book of beginnings. If you want to know God's idea on very, very many things, I dare say on almost anything, you go to the book of Genesis, because that's where it is first mentioned. And there's no better place to speak about time than where it begins. That's Genesis 1. Today's message is simple. And this is, I'll do what teachers normally like to do. I'll tell you what I want to tell you. Then I'll tell it to you. Then after I've told you, I'll tell you what I told you. So this is the entire point of today's message. In God's eyes, time is a tool to create beauty. Whereas in our eyes, it could look like it's a tool for torture. Let me repeat and put them together. Whereas in our eyes, time can look like a tool for torture, in God's eyes, time is a tool through which he creates beauty. Genesis 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Just that mention of the first five verses of the Bible is replete with examples about literature or language that we associate with time. Words like beginning. When something has beginning, it is marked in time, meaning it'll also probably have an end. When we hear of concepts like day and night, those are measures we use to measure certain aspects of time. When we hear of things like day, that's a measure of time. Yet, at the beginning of all of that literature about time, at the beginning of all those markers of time, the Bible places God at its very beginning, and it says, in the beginning, God. I'm happy that it doesn't say in the beginning matter, or in the beginning a force, or in the beginning any other thing. It says in the beginning God. God is placed at the beginning. So God is, he transcends the beginning, but he is present to initiate the beginning, and he will want to use the beginning. Now, that sounds poetic and everything, or philosophical, but it is important because beginnings are powerful. Beginnings are powerful. How we often begin things is a strong indicator of how they will proceed. When we as a country, and I'm speaking from the context of Kenya, when we as a country often see strife as a component of change, we're doing nothing new but echoing the same ethos that is characteristic of our beginning. In fact, our founding father once asked, were we given independence or did we snatch independence? He asked the question in Swahili, tulipewa uhuru ama tulinyakua uhuru? And when the people answered that we were given independence, he had very unpleasant words to say before he reminded people that we got our independence through snatching. And it is no wonder that if this is the way we began as a country, every time we have had to make some significant sort of change in this country, it has often been characterized with quite an amount of strife. Why? Because it seems something about how we continue is pegged to, or is reminiscent to, how we began. And just think about many other areas of your life and life as you know it, that how things begin is very reminiscent of how they will continue to continue. It's unpleasant to say countries like the United States have expanded their territory through a combination of aggression and extermination and racism, and as a result their current boundaries and a lot of the American continuity has a lot to do with also the same principles that underpinned its beginning. I had the privilege of living in the country of Tanzania, which got its independence through the process of talk, and Tanzanians up to now still leverage similar principles to this particular day. I'm belaboring the point that beginnings are powerful because they determine how things continue. And in the case of nationhood, that is true. But then there's a certain aspect when you read Genesis 1 verses 1 and 2 that often makes us nervous about time. And it is those words that are written and says now, in verse 2, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. That first half of verse 2 about darkness and void and everything being everywhere. Many times when we think of our beginnings, when we think about time, for us it is torture. Because a lot of our beginnings are punctuated with exactly those words, formlessness, voidness, darkness, deep darkness, seem to be the things that characterize our life. And when we think about time, for many of us it is the continuity of these particular things. What's more, the Bible says, and God said, let there be light. You do know that God lights up voidness and God lights up this formlessness. And it would seem that this God who is introducing this thing called time is actually apparently appearing or seems to be malicious, because that which initially was formless, that initially which was void, at least had the privilege of darkness about it. But when God appears on the scene, introducing time, which I am contesting, he's using it as a tool, initially it seems, or would seem, it is an implement of torture, because that which, yes, was void, that which, yes, was formless, had the privilege of darkness upon it. But now when God shows up, he asks for light. And the tools of time initially would seem to be a bother, because that which had the privilege of anonymity of darkness is now going to be lit with the light of God that he is showing up with as he introduces time in the picture. And you know, in a practical and real sense, the reason you do not engage with God very deeply is because you fear that should God be allowed into your life, he will light up the mess that is your life. That if you allow God into your life, that the voidness that has characterized you, he will be able to make bare. That if you allow God into your life, that the formlessness that has been hidden in some anonymous darkness, he will light up. And you don't want to come too close to him because you fear that his light will expose you. In fact, John would later on say in the New Testament that this is the condemnation, not that light has come into the world, but that men do not come into the light lest their deeds be lit up. Friends, I want to suggest again strongly, like just as I began, for God, light is a tool to bring beauty. It is not an implement of torture. Because if you would do things many of us do, which is go to the end of a movie or go to the end of a book and just read how the story ends, in Genesis 1, when you read verse 31, the Bible says, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." If the story ends on day one, then you probably have a case to say, like, no, when God comes and time is just a time, a thing to extend our torch. And friends, yes, if the story ended on day one, yes, if the story ended with you just being rebuked by the Holy Spirit and convicted only by the Holy Spirit about your drug or your duplicity or about your addiction, if the story only ended there, then yes, maybe you'd have a case to say that God in time is only out to torture us. But the story does not end with a conviction of the Holy Spirit. The story does not end with a rebuke in the sermon. The story ends with a God keen to restore us. The story ends with a God who has prepared for us a place where he wants to always live with us. The story ends with a God who wants to rehabilitate us. The story ends with a God who, whatever he lights up in time, he will make sure he builds up over time. So the story does not end in day one, but God keeps coming and coming, day one and day two and day three and day four. And by the time he is in day six, the Bible says he himself is looking at his own work and he says, "It is very good." Why? Because in the hands of God, time is a tool through which he makes beauty. But how? There are two things that make this to be true, but all of them in the 6 days of creation, when God introduces the concept of time and we see him using time, what God does and reveals to us is a set of beautiful principles. In fact, from this point onwards, throughout scripture and throughout life, one would suggest that life is revealed to be governed by principles that God is keen to reveal in his word. so that as these people understand and use those principles, they are able to get a life of success and significance. Two key principles jump out to us about how God is then able to use time as a tool through which he makes beauty. Number one, let's just quickly read as much of Genesis 1 as we can. We stopped initially at verse 5. Then let's now continue. And God said, let their firmament be in the midst of the waters to divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, let the waters that are under the firmament be gathered together so that dry land may appear. And it was so. And God said, let the waters that are under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and that dry land may appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering of the waters he called the sea. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree bearing fruit after its kind, in whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after its kind, and the trees yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after its kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day. And God said, let there be lights upon the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for lights and for seasons and for days and for years, and let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the face of the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made also the stars, and God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth and to rule over the day and over the night, and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw the light that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creatures that have life, the fowl that fly above the earth and in the open firmament of the heaven. By then we are reaching the fifth day, and you can begin seeing the principles of how God has moved or is moving from an earth that is described in day zero and in day one as being formless and void, and moving towards the earth which by day six he will be able to say it was very good. Principle number one of how God uses time as a tool to make beauty and not time as a tool of torture is you begin realizing everything you read from day one where we've reached up to this time is how God uses time as a tool to create beauty is principle number one is that product always comes after process, and product always reflects process. Let me repeat that. Principle number one of how God uses time as a tool to produce beauty is that product always comes after process, and product always reflects process. And God said, let there be great lights. That was a process. And there was two great lights, the sun to rule over the day, the moon to rule over the night. That is product. And God said, let the waters that are beneath the earth come together so that dry land may appear. That's the process. and dry land came, and that is a product. And God said, let the earth bring forth abundantly herb bearing seed after its own kind, trees bearing fruit with their seed in themselves after their own kind. And they came, and that is product. And you always see that is the pattern and the principle that God uses consistently from day one all the way to the very last day, that the product will always come after the process, but that the product will be a reflection of the process. And that when this is repeated from day one through to day six, God is able to change a world that was initially formless, void, and with darkness all the way to the depths. God is able to change through this process the world from formless, void, and dark into something he himself declares it is beautiful, and is able to do that using time as a tool. But this only becomes so when product comes after process. Let this begin to sink in, then I can bring it closer to you. If God had said, let there be light, and for some reason the light refuses, he would not be able to say it was good. If God, when he said, let there be birds in the firmament, and the birds refuse to come for some reason, we don't know which reason, but for some reason it doesn't happen, then we would be stuck with a formlessness and the voidness that we have in day one, and God would not be able to come to day six and say it was very beautiful. The reason God is able to come to day six and we have something that is very beautiful, it is because he speaks and it stands, he commands and it comes to be. And in every case, always, the product comes after the process. And you see God using certain things all consistently in this process. Number one is God wants or has envisioned something that he wants to be. Then number two, God commands it to come into being. Then number three, God takes time to review if what he intended and what he has realized agree. And it is only when intention and realization agree that God declares it to be good, and only then does he proceed to the next step. Please notice, I'm not just blabbering around. I'm stating something that is practical, even for our very own life. Number one, God has an intention that he wants to bring to existence. Number two, God commands that intention to be in reality. Number three, God takes time to review whether intention and reality are in agreement. And only when intention and reality are in agreement does God proceed to declare it to be good and then proceed to the next step. And I ask in love again, is principle number one in effect in our lives? Yes, I know we are a TikTok generation and an Instagram generation and an instant coffee generation and an instant mail generation and an instant satisfaction generation. And we somehow have come to falsely believe that we can short circuit process and have quality product, that we can move from darkness and desolation in our lives and move to greatness instantly. We've come to equate that, to imagine that life moves at the speed of the likes that we get on Instagram or on Facebook or on whichever platform. But no, friends, some things and most of the things that actually matter in life and the things that will actually change us from zero to something take a process. It takes process to change you from a student to a career person. It takes you process to convert you from a teenager into an adult. It takes process to convert you from a sinner to a saint. It takes process before the product can be. And if we short circuit the process of how we do our dating, it'll be reflected in the product called our marriage. If we short circuit the process we call our evangelism, it will be reflected in the product of what we call our disciples. If we short circuit the process called our Bible study, it will be reflected in the product we call the Christian living. I ask in love again. For I'm not just speaking of things that happened probably 6,000 years ago. I'm speaking about things we live with every day. Perhaps the reason we are tortured with weak disciples or vacillating marriages or careers that are not progressing, perhaps the reason we feel these things we experience in time are just but nothing but torture has everything to do with us violating how God uses time, because in the hands of God, process determines product. And when process determines product and it is done well, then in the hands of God, time becomes a tool through which he creates beauty. When in the hands of God, what is intended is painstakingly followed through until it is realized, then we can hear the commendation of God who says, when intention and realization agree, then he says it is very good. Do we take time like God did to examine whether what we are achieving is in harmony with what we intended? You've been dating that guy from first year. Have you taken just time to ask yourself, have you realized what you wanted? Is your life and spirituality increasing? Is your fervor for purity enhanced? Is your conscience unviolated? Do you genuinely take time to ask yourself what I intended when I entered this relationship and what I am realizing being achieved? Or are we just drifting through life? So God uses process to bring about product. And in it all, you see him taking time, number one, to speak about intention. Number two, to confirm if what is intended is what is realized before he says it's good. Another thing you see him doing in the entire activity of moving from process to product is you see him repeatedly separating things. In day one, he separates day from night. In day two, he separates firmament from the earth. In day three, he separates land from sea. In day four, he puts the sun and the moon. In day five, he separates land animals. He separates sea dwelling animals from the birds. In day six, he separates land animals from man. He is constantly, as he moves through process to get us to product, one of the tools in his arsenal as he leverages this principle is the entire perspective of separation. And let me in love say this. If God of heaven and earth does see the necessity to be able to separate things as he moves from process to product, who do you think you are that you will go around the necessity to at times separate certain things from your life? Who do you imagine you are that you can be able to arrive to beautiful product in your life while trying to embrace any and all and everything, good and bad, negative and positive, all embraced in your life, and somehow imagine that you will get to a product that is good and beautiful and perfect? Let me try to be a teacher here. God, what I'm trying to do is I'm unpacking how God, at number one, uses time as a tool through which he moves us from darkness and desolation to bring us to beauty. And in point number one of that idea was that God takes time to review whether what he intended and what he realizes is good, and so should we. And point number two about that, how God moves from process to product, is he does that through the principle of separation. Why does God have to separate? Number one is God has to separate because when he arrives on the scene, some things are unnaturally joined together. So when God begins, for instance, saying, let there be light, light cannot be naturally conjoined with darkness. Otherwise, that's a misnomer. So he has to separate them. See, and everything is together. So he has to create a firmament so that those things that are unnaturally joined together have to be separated. So as God is moving through process to bring the product of beauty, separation becomes an inevitable thing that he leverages to be able to make sure that those things that are unnaturally put together can be separated. And let me love again say, what is true with land and sea is true with our lives, both spiritually, relationally, and practically. Now, when God will be allowed to create beauty within our lives, he will have to be given permission to separate things that are unnaturally joined together in the process of bringing the product of beauty within our lives. God also has to use separation because through separation, he creates environments of productivity. It is through separation that he creates land upon which plants can be able to grow. It is through separation that he creates a firmament upon which birds can be able to fly. It is through separation that he creates the sea upon in which sea creatures can be able to thrive. It is through separation that he creates a firmament where the sun, the moon, the stars can be able to be placed. So through separation, God creates environments where distinct environments, where different things can be able to thrive. And this he does as a part of what he does in the process to produce the product. Dear friends, when God uses time, he is not in the business of torturing us by merely lighting up our mess. In our eyes, time is a thing that tortures us because it reminds us of our desolation, it reminds us of our emptiness, it reminds us of our lack, it reminds us of our darkness. But in the hands of God, time is a tool that he uses to produce beauty because he uses process to bring about product. And part of that activity of moving from process to product will involve the actions of separation. And this separation is important because through them, things that are unnaturally joined together, like drugs in your lungs and gossip in your lips and fear in your heart and fornication in your life, those are unnatural things that are joined in your life. God is able to separate them. And as he simultaneously separates them using process to bring about product, God simultaneously creates environments where more beautiful things can be able to thrive, so that once that mind, which was a playground for demons, can now become the dwelling house for angels. And once that life, which was the dwelling place of contra philosophies, now becomes the place where the ideas of God can thrive. And once that lung where drugs was a dwelling place can become the place where pure fresh air can be. Once where those muscles were inundated with things that bedwarfed them becomes the place where healthy exercises allows them to reach the highest. Once where those thoughts were only filled with fear that paralyzed them becomes the place where God gives sound mind and power and goodness into them. God, as he moves us from through process to product, has to separate and simultaneously removes things that are unnaturally joined to us and creates in us environments where those things of beauty can be able to thrive. The million-dollar question is this: are you allowing him to? Reality number two. When you read the Genesis account of how God moves us from being, how God uses time as a tool, is When you read everything in Genesis 1, it was not bought, it was built. In case you're getting lost of how I'm going, let me say it again. Reality number one about how God uses time as a tool to bring beauty is that God works from process to product. And as God works from process to product, he takes time to review what he's doing. He takes time to separate things that are unnatural, and it takes time to create environments that are productive. Reality number two, how God uses time as a tool to bring beauty, is that in everything he does, in Genesis 1, he does not buy, he builds. Because God knows everything worth having in life is not bought, it is built. He takes time himself. He does not procure light, he commands light. He takes time himself. He does not procure land, he makes, he creates the land. Anything worth having in life, God demonstrates to us the second principle of the process of making beauty, is that anything worth having in life is built. It is not bought. I want that to sink in before I suggest what the implication of that is. Yeah, I know it's an uncomfortable thing and you're struggling with it, because you're busy having an affair with that lecturer, because through that affair with him, you're able to buy yourself your way to a good degree. And this idea that things worth having in life are built and not bought is an uncomfortable thing. Yes, I know the degree, the job you're getting, you've bought it with bribe money and you've not built a career and it's becoming uncomfortable. But let me remind you again how God uses time to be able to create things of beauty is he builds them. He doesn't just merely buy them. And why is this significant? It is because how you get things is how you keep them. Because God is able to bring to place a world of beauty through the process of creation, the same power he uses to create is the same power he uses to sustain. Similarly, in our lives, how we get things is how we keep them. You see governments in the world that were acquired through the butt of the gun are sustained by the butt of the gun. Governments that were acquired through bribery and force are maintained through bribery and force. Relationships that are acquired through deceit and snatching are maintained through deceit and snatching. Degrees and promotions that are acquired through deceit and sleeping around are generally maintained by a similar process. But equally, a name that is acquired through honesty and integrity and uprightness is maintained by honesty and integrity and uprightness. Because God understands this principle of life, he took time in Genesis 1 to model it to us. And therefore, the second way God uses time as a tool to be able to create beauty is that rather than rush things and try and get things bought in one day, he spans it out for an entire week to show us how meticulously, when he is making the land, he focuses entirely on only the land as if there was nothing else. And when he comes to make the animals, he meticulously makes every animal as though there was nothing else. And when he eventually will make you and me, the crowning act of creation, he will focus on us as though there was nothing else, because he knows what he's doing here. He is modeling for us how time, well leveraged, can become a tool of beauty, and shows us that anything worth having is not bought, it is built. He takes time to build the land. He takes time to build the firmament. He takes time to build my arteries and my veins and my venules and my capillaries. And he then takes time to build my lungs and takes time to build my eyes and puts my sinews and my flesh together. He takes time to put breath in me. He takes time to build me and everything, because he knows what he is showcasing is that the things worth having in life are built. They are not bought. Because he knows how we get them is how we will keep them. No wonder when later on in Genesis 3, when we fall in sin, because God had built us and not merely bought us, he didn't just come and take it lightly. He came back and did everything by the same creative force, Christ, who made us. He came and redeemed us again by the same creative Christ. How does God use time? God uses time as a tool to make beauty. But for this to be true, he knows that the things worth having in life will not be bought, they'll be built. Let me ask you, what are you striving to have in life today? Are you busy buying it, or are you busy building it? A marriage worth having is built, it's not bought. A name worth having is built, it's not bought. But for that to be true, we need to turn to God. So friends, I know time has been a thing that you've looked as a weapon of torture, because as time has spanned out, your weaknesses have become more apparent and glaring. The voids in your life, the darkness in your life has become more keen and clear. And so when you hear the theme, "In His time," you've become nervous. Because for you, time has somewhat been the thing that tortures you. But may I suggest to you, if you sow time the way God sees it, and if you use time the way God uses it, then you will allow him to lead you the way he desires to lead you. In the hands of God, time is a tool to create beauty. But for that to be true, two principles need to be true. Number one, things need to be built, not bought. Number two, product will always come after process. That will entail him needing to separate certain things from and in and through your life. And that will need him to have you review and reflect whether intention and realization agree. That will need you to make him allow you to understand that what is important is built and not bought, because how you get it is how you keep it. And the big question is this: will you allow him to be able to use time as a tool to make beauty in your life? Or will you allow yourself to continuously be merely tortured with time viewed as a tool for torture? Whatever God lights up, God creates. When he called the world dark, void, and formless in Genesis 1:2, he didn't stop. The story didn't end in verse 2. It continues all the way to verse 31, where God uses time, day 1, time, day 2, time, day 3, time, day 4, all the way to day 6, and he's able to create beauty. You know what? He can do that for everything in your life. But you need to come to him so that he will build you, not merely buy you. You need to come to him and trust his processes so that he will make that product of beauty in your life. True, That will involve separation. True. That will involve inspection and introspection. True. That may involve things that look uncomfortable. But remember, whatever God lights up, because he views time as a tool to create beauty, he will faithfully come to it time and time again until it has moved from darkness and desolation to beauty. Lord, my prayer is you'll help us be able to see time the way you do, so that we will submit you to you to do as you'd please. Teach us to trust the process, because as long as it is good, the product will be good. Teach us, Lord, to be built in you and not to be merely bought by the world. Teach us to be pliant as you separate, as you inspect, and as you introspect us. Teach us, Lord, to see time as a tool to bring beauty. And Father in heaven, may that beauty be brought in our life today, this week, and throughout eternity. For in your hands we place ourselves. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.